predictable nature of medical device technology development, in quite in contrast to biotech and other forms. What's really driven this industry has been a very, very kind of stable model for the way products are developed. At the same time, I think it would say that we're testing the limits of where technology goes, and really we see that in terms of things like drug device convergence, robotics. We may have a whole lot of companies out there who are taking device technology in radical new directions and testing them that never been tested before. I remember being at a conference a couple of years ago on robotics, and one of the surgeons stood up and said, listen, this whole area of robotics and computing is going to take us places we've never been before. We've got to start to live to learn that things like discomfort and dislocation and distance as part of our everyday practice. So what I suggest is that we're testing these kind of hard industry trends, industry trends in the device industry, come out and play out in one very specific area called advanced computing. So let me start with Dana and Ryan, because you guys are the guys who taste best on new technology in this space. As you look at what we've been defining as body computing, what we've heard this morning on the panel, talking about body computing, is this more than CRM in its various iterations that we've seen? Are you taking depth in this space in the furthest extensions of that? And Ryan, obviously, on Proteus, I'm giving a review, talking about the Proteus investment in data, tell us what AP is doing in this space. Dan, if you have any companies that you put in this category of your portfolio, something that you think your radar is doing more these days?
Sure, we do, but maybe it would be helpful from a context point of view to talk a little bit about the kinds of things we're seeing more broadly across body computing. So certainly there's, you start with, I think you mentioned implantables that we've all known, ICDs and pacemakers over the years. Obviously there's innovation going on there. A lot of it happening at large companies, but people trying to do things like leadless defibrillators, defibrillators that interventional cardiologists can put in that sit in the inferior vena cava, et cetera. So there are some things going on there. Where we've seen an explosion, of course, is in what we're broadly defined as neuromodulation. If you look at the IN VIVO, David's got upstairs, and look at the areas Medtronic alone is looking at, I can tell you we're seeing them across, you know, just a few areas, toxins, depression, spinal cords, pain, epilepsy, migraine, inflammation, clutter, headaches, asthma, incontinence, et cetera. There's a lot of that. So that's an area that we see a lot of interest in, and we'll talk a little more of what we're doing there. Then I'd say the next group of things that we're seeing a lot of are these wearable devices, whether a smart patch or there's some type of activity monitor, you know, with a location, GPS. Where is grandma when she doesn't know where she is? Where's your kid? You know, something that's wearable that can handle that. Looks at motion, looks at body position with accelerometers, et cetera. Looks at how you're taking your medication, the patterns of your activity, what you're eating, what you're not eating. We're seeing those that are mounted on the ear, mounted on the wrist, all over the body. So we're seeing a lot of those things. And then we're seeing a lot of the infrastructure that supports all body computing. So we're seeing things like wireless networks, very specific hardware with very user interfaces that are very friendly for patients. We're seeing things like components, like battery, new battery technologies that are fueled by glucose, by body motion, et cetera. So we're seeing a lot of things in those areas. Sensor technology, every day I hear about some new sensor technology, a new array of sensors, ways to use sensor technology in a closed loop, tied to drug delivery. There was a mention, Chris had that earlier. And then I think there was a mention at lunch in this vast amount of data. So we see a lot of interest that are focused on the bioinformatics. How do you capture the data? How do you sort that data? How do you present it in a digestible way to people? What we've done so far is we've done some smart patch technology around heart failure, and we've done four things in neuromodulation, starting with NeuroPace about 10 years ago. These do take a long time. Around epilepsy, we have something in asthma. We have something in migraine and cluster headaches. We also have something in sleep apnea. So we're probably fairly well exposed to this area. Probably won't do a lot more in the neuromodulation area, but we are looking in this more wellness activity sector.
Great. Doug, let me talk to you again as panel, and this morning we had conventionally defined device companies. You come at this from a very different perspective, that of the computer company. Talk to our tech instruments, interest in this space. What is it that you got, that you know about this whole opportunity that the guys on this morning's panel don't know? Doing this as a kind of OEM supplier to existing medical devices, doing our own, and I know you also have a venture arm in this space. How will the venture arm play out differently than kind of TI's internal efforts to get into this business, David?
I'm not sure that we need another venture capital.
You'll give us the key to
say, oh, yeah.
Medical device. Got huge buyouts. But the one company that I would consider the pure play in the space, cardio men with US IPO, saying the market conditions weren't favorable. How do you read the end game exit strategy for companies in this space right now, either as IPO or as M&A targets for big companies? Entrance to the marketplace of new buyers, companies like Honeywell, 3M, which has been quiet in the healthcare space for a long time, would suggest that there may be some premium to the debt organizations have to, by some argument, pay out in order to take the Fed. I think in a very different sort of perk, by the fact that the perk close to being through the vascular business. Do you think the fact that you're not looking at those kinds of organizations to come in or even the test instrument suggests that the premium to these companies will be even bigger if companies put their toes in the water in this case? Dana and Ryan, let me turn it back to you guys because, you know, John's obviously positing a fairly rosy scenario. Do you read the same way? Are you thinking in terms of exits already for the companies?
One thought that occurs to me is that the companies that are the companies that are
you're now K2, so obviously bring a perspective of what K2 is in single case. But you also guide us for that time. As you go back and forth between your VC and your corporate talk, what would guide you? How would guide you to talk between you just a couple of minutes ago?
Well, first of all, if I was guiding, I would let Dan Schultz go ahead of me in this conversation. If I was guided, however, I think that obviously part of the leadership at Guidon was a huge supporter of Latitude, you know, the program which was connecting, obviously, patients and doctors and that information broadly and plot what Medtronic's done with CareLink and other things that are going on in that area. So I fundamentally was a big supporter of that. To echo some of the things John said, that we now have coming to meet us to talk about these kind of things, IBM, Intel, Siemens, GE Healthcare, rather than the usual suspects, which used to be Boston Scientific, Guidon, Abbott, those people coming to talk to us about this. I do think, really to tie to Jeff's comment at lunch, though, no one's going to pay up for this unless it's fully integrated into a profitable business model that exists today, or we have some form of killer application in these two, in these body computing areas, and we don't have that yet. The implantable devices, I would argue, ICDs, pacemakers, the neurostim-type products, yes. But I'm yet to see a killer application in something that's built a market yet in the body computing, the external body computing. Once that happens, then I think those players will pay up. When you don't have a market, you know, you're paying on the come. So I think that's a little bit of a challenge.
But the focus play, that's the difference that we'll get to here. But we're not going to get to we're not going to get a good, you know, multi-billion-dollar market unless it's possible to market. So the brand that let's talk about the FDA now, maybe we have to create a pathway, a new pathway for drug device conversion technologies. Do you see the whole area of biocomputing requiring a whole new pathway, a whole new approach to the approval of these devices, or do you think this fits very naturally with what you're doing in the device part of the FDA? I'm
what works and what doesn't work. Do I think that we need a totally new regulatory paradigm? Probably not, and probably one of those things that we try to avoid is having to go to Congress or proposing new regulatory pathways, because sometimes it's one of those situations where you need to be careful what you're asking for. And I know that there are people that have proposed a census for combination products and a census for tissue engineering and a center for this and a center for that. I think that, quite frankly, we have a number of different tools, and from where I sit, it's really a matter of adopting those tools to the environment that we're working in. So I do think that as we sort of do our technology forecasting, and again, we probably do it a little bit differently than some of my colleagues here, but in sort of looking at where devices are going, certainly computerized devices, telemedicine, home health care, all of these things have been high on our list for a number of years and continue to be high on our list. And in order to make sure that we're ready to review these products in a rational and intelligent way, a big part of our push in recent years has been in terms of bringing on the appropriate expertise. Because frankly, if we have people who are experts in biocompatibility and in metallurgic testing, that's not going to help us a whole lot when we start dealing with these computerized systems and telemedicine systems and all this other stuff. So I think that we are going to be involved. We obviously have not a lot of choice in the matter, and I think that we are positioned to be involved. I think one of the things that is very helpful for us is to work with companies early in the game as opposed to late in the game to understand what it is they're trying to do and try to figure out what the appropriate regulatory pathway is. In devices, I think we're fortunate in the sense that we've always been sort of flexible in terms of applying our regulatory pathways in different ways, but we need to understand exactly what it is you're trying to do. To come in and say, we want to buy computing, is not going to be terribly helpful, quite frankly. We need to have a much more defined, clear understanding of what it is a company is trying to do. And then I think we can exercise what I consider to be sort of our dual role. One is as a gatekeeper, and we certainly have that role, and we need to maintain that role and try to do it as clearly as possible, but also as a facilitator. And I think we actually can and do, in many cases, work in both of those regards.
So you mentioned the resource aspect of what's in the field. If I can find out, what's the proposal for a transmission device company about the FDA, is that when you get the FDA, that if you're going for a conventional implant or a spine device or a catheter-based cardiovascular technology, that there's actually an FDA sweet spot, you get quick and appropriate approval process. But when we're testing a clinical phase new technology, there is the ability of the agency to get up to speed quickly on that is considered. Are the FDA ready right now to handle these kinds of technologies in your view?
Well, I think the answer is yes and no. I mean, I think it's absolutely true that when we talk about, Me Too technologies that we've done hundreds of times, the pathway is very clear both for companies as well as for our review staff. When we start talking about new types of technologies, breakthrough technologies, the drug-eluting stents, the computerized this, the robotic that, what ends up happening is that we end up defining regulatory pathway together as we move along. And that's why, again, it's critical to start the process early on. It's not terribly helpful when a company comes in with an application for a brand new type of technology, a brand new idea that we've never seen before, and it says, you know, here's your 510K, you've got 90 days to review it, and we'll expect our approval letter, you know, in 90 days. That's not going to happen. I mean, it's just not going to happen. You know, you'll end up getting a list of questions, you know, 5 pages long, back saying, you know, can you help us understand this, help us understand that. And I think that, you know, one way to try to avoid that is to come in early and explain what it is you're trying to do. We're very open to having people come in and do seminars and things like that. If there is an industry-wide group that is looking at a particular area or an academic group that's looking at a particular area, for people to come in and give some type of a seminar or a continuing education type of activity, that's something that can really help us to prepare for these new things. So I think, yeah, the answer to your question is yes, absolutely. It takes us longer, it takes more effort, more time to work on the breakthrough technologies than it does, on the 50th, spine screw or whatever.
You talk about the MRI reality and the post-traumatic with the scarring device. Could you recall a couple of years ago, over 9 years, this field had started to march into the approval process? It was never over from the beginning.
Yeah, I mean, I live in Washington. And we do read the newspapers. I think that one of the things that was alluded to this morning is that we live in an environment where people have set the bar very high, and there are very high expectations. And some of that, again, has been created by the successes of the medical device industry. David Cassak, my predecessor, went to a meeting and they said, well, how come device trials are so much smaller than drug trials? And his answer was, because the device trials do work. And I think to some extent that's true. You know, we don't talk about 5% improvement or this or that. You know, they're really sometimes pretty big deltas. And, really need that in other patients. So, but I do think that when post-market issues arise, one of the obligations that we have is to try to understand what happened and to, as we like to describe it, feedback back into the life cycle for the next generation device. I think in some cases that can be a very positive thing. I mean, we try to learn both the positives and the negatives. So, you know, we've been reviewing products for years and years and not seeing problems. There's no reason why we can't streamline the approach for the next generation. On the other hand, if we have devices where we have seen problems, then we need to look at those problems and we need to try to figure out what is the best way to first evaluate this. I don't subscribe to the idea that, you know, because you have a problem or a perceived problem with the medical device, that necessarily means that the way to address that is just to double the size of the pre-market study. I think that's a very sort of knee-jerk approach, which is sometimes appropriate, but many times not appropriate. And but I do think that yes, we have to look at that information, and we do have to factor it into the way we look at the entire review process. And by that I mean both the pre-market review as well as additional post-market surveillance requirements.
David. Yeah, I was just going to comment on that. I think in any new emerging area, the companies or the ecosystem that's participating in that has a responsibility for two-way education. I think to Dan's point, I think that experience would tell us, and we certainly recommend our companies, that you go and talk to the FDA much earlier than later. that you do it in a form like Dan just described, where you're not going to get strict guidance, but you're going to have an open conversation which educates both sides. I would argue we recommend the exact same thing with CMS, and we recommend the exact same thing with the Patent Office, where the Patent Office will give you the opportunity and come in and talk about your technology as you're starting to file IP and they get a better understanding of it. So when you talk to ex-FDA people, to a person, our people that worked in the Patent Office, they all recommend going in earlier. The fear, obviously, from industry has always been you're going to hear answers you don't want to hear, or you're not, quote, ready for that. But I think the FDA, the Patent Office, and CMS, if you position the conversation correctly and get that agreement up front, which they're very open to, having that dialogue very early, especially in an emerging area like we're in here that we're talking about today, is extremely important.
Let me just talk about the point on the regulatory approval
You solved that one.
This is a high risk of sounding Pollyannish, but we have been impressed and surprised by a couple of our topics by going to them very early. By going to CMS early, the extent to which they have gone out of their way to facilitate by payment a high-cost clinical trial that one of our companies engaged in, and it's invariably in a situation where they have a cost problem because some existing therapy has got exploding utilization and is very high-cost therapy. I've also, over the past, been involved in some of the private payers, and I would say I'm actually seeing at this point a bit more sort of forward-thinkingness on bringing low-cost lowering therapies to market from CMS than I'm seeing from some of the large private payers. Could easily explain. But I think that there's a respective view at CMS now when they have a cost problem, when it's a very clear and identified tribal-specific category, the sort of total population cost that aggregating inpatient, outpatient care, and drugs, and else, for a specific condition, that's a harder story to make.
Yeah, I would agree. I think that in part of that dialogue with CMS, a lot of it will come down to how you design the clinical trials, and they'll have efficacy, but they almost might have economics tied to those trials that might be a little different. The other thing, quite frankly, part of body computing, because it's such a broad area, we're focused on implantable devices that are PMA-type devices, there's certainly an opportunity for lower regulatory hurdles
right.
510K devices.
Right.
We like looking at markets where there's kind of an intersection of the consumer and science, where the consumer's paying for it, whether it's aesthetics or we get a company Invisalign with braces or something like that. We think there's big opportunities there. And those might be more of the activity lounge or something for sports medicine, something in that area. We'd certainly be open to looking at those. So there it's going to be either a patient pay most likely or a company will pay for it with one of the wellness programs. But I think that is one of the parts of this equation that needs to be solved for is the reimbursement and what we're going to need to do to get reimbursement.
Well, you're saying, let me turn it over to Doug for just a second because my goal is that
computer-based medical devices. Is it on the medical side? Is it on the computing side?
do you have, when you go to dialogues with medical device companies, is the expertise to benefit on your side or your computer companies on their side or their medical companies?
Yeah, well, certainly the ultimate value, in our view, is with the medical device application, and so be clear about that. What we do think, though, is that access to technologies, whether it's sensor technology through MEMS or, quite frankly, what I hear particularly in implantables and in the consumer medical space is what you think of as low power, TI, isn't low power to me. And so there's a lot of value in our ability to supply lower and lower and lower power, whether it's microcontrollers or signal processors or particularly RF in this area of body computing, the wireless link. So where we can add unique value in the area of power or size, those are areas that are really rewarding. But it's really clear, it's ultimately the application of that to the medical problem where the true value, we're not going to get the business unless there's that sort of breakthrough in patient outcomes or cost. So we're real clear about who's really driving the ship in these things and what our role is.
A lot of discussions for the fundamental makeup before the kind of wow factor around these technologies, the what they can do with the goal and those. But there is a kind of, science fiction, but there is a kind of wow that sort of leads us to the fundamentals. It even kind of raises some questions about whether conventional device financing model and company development models still have a role in this place, or if not, you're going to make the argument that a company like Westfield Labs is probably fairly conventional trajectory, not raising a whole lot of money to pull men take off often down, but they've got some critical problems to do, but by the same time, you start getting your step actuated device, the kind of style problems inside the body, it sounds like
I think the market of those is something that is both disruptive. And therefore create the kind of pain we talked about at lunch. And also something that is kind of predatorial. So somebody coming in from a completely different area with a lot of resources that's going to threaten how care is currently delivered. So it's, it can come in on a big bird, it can come in on a little insect. And either way, those are the dynamics of something that's going to get both traditional funding and plus time for an entry into the IPO market, in which it's really going to get a favorable debut, or it could be something that is going to find a very healthy group of potential acquirers out of corporates. So, we've talked about little trends. We talked about a model, like a cardio-MEMS, I would encourage people, and I'm interested in the audience's perspective as well, on things that they see as truly changing the way in which something that's done centrally or in an acute care facility being done in a different setting or functionally in a very different way. I have a few in my own mind, but I think those are the things that are of greatest interest to both investors on the public venture side as well as the corporate acquisition side.
Yeah.
Sure.
You had to bring that up, right, Alan? No. The important thing is it will get there. It will get there. I think the first thing that I would say is that we really need a lot of work looking at what these business models are truly going to be. And I agree, if we can take things to a less resource-intensive place and provide the same quality therapy and potentially make that more convenient and hopefully get better outcomes, that's great. I think so. It's not only the technology. I'm not as concerned about the technology existing. It's more of how that technology is packaged, what the user interface looks like, and what the business model is around that. I think there's a lot of uncertainty still on the business model. And again, I'm not talking about neurostim or implantable ICDs or pacemakers, but more in that area, I think there's a challenge. You ask about how we would think about the financing different. The big change I see, and we have a unique perspective because we have a large IT practice in green tech as well as a broad healthcare practice, We are partnering and working with people like Texas Instruments, IBM, Siemens, GE. We're talking to them at the inception of these companies, where normally we would not look for a strategic investor in an area we know. Like, we would normally not bring a St. Jude or a Medtronic or Boston Scientific until later, maybe a Series B, Series C, when we need them for either credibility or help us with clinicals or something there. We're bringing these other players in very early because of the technology expertise and the need to integrate their knowledge earlier in the process than you might in a medical device, where we know what we can actually do better in the early process than what the big company can do in normal medical devices. In this case, we don't own that same level of expertise. We don't own the networks and the understanding in that area to the same degree, and I think it's very important. And so it's a different dialogue. Then I think you've got another person that's committed to the area for a number of reasons and will also help with future financing to raise money and also participate in the finance. So that would be the only thing that I think would be different in how these companies might evolve at the very early stage.
Thank you. Thank you, because part of the program has been the intention of the device to start with.
You have to remind me of that.
Still half of what neural patients raise.
Well,
no,
let me ask this. As we've moved farther away, as we've started to move away from the traditional device model, both in terms of the pathway to market and the business model, mm-hmm. So getting more into uncharted territory and business models, and what we're doing in part is layering on additional risks to a project, right? In addition to traditional device risks of technology and regulatory, you've got business model risk and what. And that kind of an environment, we like to think about financing strategy in the way that it can be risk reducing, and not just risk reducing in terms of having all the financing you need, but financing partners that can actually help to reduce some of the other risks, some of the operational, technical, or as we move into consumer oriented business models, some of the market and go to market risks. And that's where the dialogue that Dan is describing with the IBMs and Intels and Microsofts of the world, get particularly interesting if we're moving into business models that are more consumer oriented.
One of the things we see that challenge traditional device financing model is that the detective approaches with systems, a lot of the technology is diagnostic and monitoring technology. And you're hearing now sort of about the genomics and those kinds of things, but I consider those to be a biotech type. But if someone walked into Carlyle and came to the diagnostic technology, you would have quickly shown them to the door. Does that contribute? It's about prevention rather than intervention. Later on, are you guys testing that on different times?
Sure, we can add some perspective. Kleiner Perkins is one of the founders of HyberTech. Okay, Guidant ended up selling HyberTech 10 years later for a dollar. Okay, and the reason why, PSA test is an important test, but how much do you think they get paid for PSA test? $4. Okay, we're also the founder of Genomic Health, and Genomic Health gets $3,500 for their test. And it's all around the value of the test and what it's telling you. So I think we're open, obviously, we've done seven other companies in molecular diagnostics that are similar to Genomic Health. Would we be interested in a straight diagnostic product? No, but there's certainly, we would look at these products, the type of products we're talking about, body computing, they could be therapy management. So if the diagnostic, the information you're getting is tied to therapy, important decisions the caregivers are giving, yes, we would be interested. So it's all around, David, I think the value proposition driven by whatever you want to call it. We normally call it therapy management technologies, not diagnostics. It's really the same. I mean, you look at healthcare, everyone pays for therapy. No one pays for the preventive, 95% of the dollars on the therapy. And we would like to try to figure out ways to move that because we think that's the right thing to do. So we would invest in those areas because we think they will become more meaningful.
Well, I know Medtronic talks a lot about disease management in various aspects. Around things like heart failure and diabetes. The pharma industry has graveyards at the back filled with disease guys who wanted to build their career in disease management. Anybody make the mistake that this is really about disease management, not about focal device therapeutics?
We don't like straight disease management. It just comes down to the business models and who's going to pay for it and how it's going to be paid for it. That's been our challenge, I think. Ryan mentioned, we look at technical and clinical challenge. We love technical and clinical challenge, and we want to solve that. We don't like market risk. And as these market risks and the risk in the market, you know, will they eat the dog food? Mm-hmm. When we saw those gnarly technical things, they better eat the dog food. And so we focused a lot on the business model and some of these risks.
Companies and general IT companies that used to be popular with the electronic health record, or the, you know, paper medical record, called different things, different algorithms. I'm not a doctor, but I'll say one thing. Patients are not doctors. And I do not think that anybody was responsible to put in the hands of a patient to populate an electronic medical record. Similarly, the kinds of things that I think
the most deals in this space are a much better scale. Is this an opportunity to have on a different scale, or is it good for the investment that you can
Yeah, again, I think it's how you define body computing. So we'll put neurostim and normal implantable pacemakers and ICDs on the left side, not talk about them. As far as the other opportunities, I would struggle to say that there's a clear path on that to get a huge valuation on something at this point. Again, and I think it's just because the market hasn't been developed yet to a point where you're launching something incremental to an existing market with the existing set of providers. Every time you introduce something new, there's winners and losers. And what we ask companies to do is to lay out exactly how it's done today and what all the economic flows are, and you'll understand the behavior that's happening today. Now insert your technology into that continuum and see what changes and try to understand that. So again, I think all we need is one or two technologies to take off and create one of those or two or three of these companies that John's talking about that have some critical mass, that have a good outcome or two, and then I think you'll see. I mean, venture capitalists are a little bit, you know, we're followers, you know, we'll go into that area, but we need to see some leading indicators to do that. Now, there are other areas in medicine that are happening now where you're seeing a bunch of convergence of different technologies and new technologies that are enabling things that would cause you to take that risk. And people are investing in these companies, so I think that's something we should say. There is some investment. We haven't seen the one or two big wins yet quite in this area. We will, I think, over the next 5 years. And then I think you'll see quite a bit of investment in there.
Anyone have a perspective?
I know. A couple of things about what we're talking about involved computing that are to the potential for a step function increment in value creation. One is that you know, in contrast to typical, when you describe typical medical devices, typical medical devices, some of these things are not technical, but they can give us the potential to create recurring annuities of revenue streams. And for that, then of course, you have to think about who the winners and losers are and what the funding sources might be, but it does have this potential for what the larger recurring revenue. Second thing is, as you move into consumer-oriented business models, to think about what that which consumers perceive as value is in some ways very radically different than consumer value is radically different than the traditional medical market. And a great example to pick up on the PSA test in diagnostics. Think about what a PSA test is reimbursed for, and then think about what consumers pay for an elective body scan, which with healthy clinical value that it has, right? That's how the actionable information provides it. This would be a non point. So, creating consumer perceived value is a very different thing than creating value in terms of some medical question.
And you really changed the rate of the paradigm. You get that recurring stream, but it's not from an unconventional throwaway disposable. I know I'm going to ask the questions and answers now. I don't know if the microphone's around. I don't see how it's bad. But are there any questions for anyone in the audience for right now?
Nobody knew how valuable this information would be. So there's perceived value evaluation by you all. And then there's this enormous value that ends up being created. But maybe it doesn't work now with payers. Maybe there need to be policy changes and maybe patients will pay. You're interested in that, obviously. Yet you made all this money off of Google or any of his internet worker. So how do you kind of think about that when you think about the power of paradigm?
Sure. We could ask Chris or some of the Boston scientific people how much money they spent to create those. I know the answer to that. It was a lot of money. And they also, if you think about it, they also had all the infrastructure in order to put that together. They had the devices. They had the ability to design the devices with that capability. They had the channel to the customer already. And so what they were able to do as a large company is you go out, you build the value proposition, and then the reimbursement will follow. For a startup company to try to do exactly what they did, I think it's extremely difficult to do. You almost have to create a totally new business model. Like a Google, Google was a seventh search engine that they figured out a way to monetize what they did. Okay, there's seventh one in. So a lot of that is just business model. So I think that was more purview of a big company.
We tend to ask a question on this question, and I'd love to hear from Leslie, Chris, anybody else. It would be great for us to leave this conference understanding how the network that is embedded in these investments that these companies have made for this important market, how they could really change care for your patients. You alluded to it at lunch, this information that's sitting in these silos. But if you could just help illuminate that, I would love to hear that. And you as a practitioner as well as the company in terms of why they developed it.
Thanks. I mean, I don't want to dominate this discussion, but I think if you just look at the primary prevention ICD school, there's not enough value for patients or referring physicians to make that decision.
Well, one of the challenges, I think you just described it, that all these systems are developed in silos. So CareLink in the beginning was fairly closed system. Latitude was Memorial, but it's still somewhat closed. Then you had your EMR system as a silo. So you end up with all these silos in healthcare where these are obviously local and regional. So you've got all these different competing things with different standards, all the people coming from standards, of course, where all these things can talk together. Then you've got revenue, you've got Google, Yahoo, Microsoft, all put in their own vault. They live all together with the world around them. And so you end up doing it with this thing. Maybe the only way you're going to get it to grow is if someone tries to develop it and figure out a way to have that functionality to get people to do it. And there are people, you know, like the audience here, that are trying to build a network to carry that information more efficiently. And what's happened today is each of the companies individually has kind of built their own back end, too. So there's been no intelligence stuff. They have to use from a back end point of view for the people trying to do that. So I do think it's the complexity of it. Eventually, if the value is high enough of what you're describing and we get there incrementally, maybe there'll be a tipping point which will happen, or that it gets dictated by a major payer or somebody. Maybe that's where it has
to come. Yeah.
Well, I mean, a major employer, GM, that, you know, we want all our patient stuff available in one place, and we can't change our patient place with all.
Well, it may also be that in this space, I mean, one of the strengths of the hospital and the as well is that that all the rules are very balanced between patients and physicians and doctors as well. And that may be that like Google and Microsoft and Facebook and I think it's up against all of these barriers that we discussed here. I probably presented to with less than $10 million investment in our company. What has been addressed here, and what I think is still part of the fundamental engine that helps young entrepreneurs who dreams to get going, is the angel investment community. And that's much less of a barrier. And it's critical in our case, and I think in a lot of cases in this area.
Yeah.
And so I wanted to comment on that.
I think angel investing is alive and well, and you know, we highly encourage entrepreneurs. We do a lot of incubations. We meet when you come to someone, but other than that, that's a huge part of the ecosystem. But family and angel investments is extremely important part of this thing.
Mm-hmm. But it's also part of it. I mean, you understand what the scope is.
It's not just a great professional
nervous system to coordinate it. Nothing to do with this meeting. You're trying to get medical information out to the public who might have not done well, which I don't know if it's a very medical interest for the hospitals and the doctors to do that. But that's about it. And I'm going after 20 minutes of lower spectrum that has to do with inside the body, which is much higher than the agenda of the spectrum. But we do that. And we have to coordinate. Many parts of the world, it's a big market, it's appropriate to perform that for them. There's another people in the middle of the year, feedback in there, and they're in common, 100% of the chances of things. It's very good. But this means a lot of action. It's about the community, not the world.
Because they're making a choice between food or polypharmacy drugs, and issues about patients who are now overwhelmed with information. And in the last surveys, in the first two health plans, what they're looking for is a trusted advisor to help them make the right decision. And I think it's an important issue, an important problem, and it's going to be an opportunity for us to help interpret this in the way that's meaningful, demonstrate value, and more importantly, demonstrate cost effectiveness technologies.
I think one of the things we haven't talked a lot is the value of the bioinformatics. You know, all this information you're collecting has incredible value. The challenge is who's consuming that information. And obviously the doctors don't want to get called in the middle of the night with a bunch of false positives. You know, the patients don't want a lot of false positives. They don't want a lot of noise. I mean, to that point, what they want is they want trusted advice. I mean, if you look, there's a website called unique visits a month, and basically what it is, it's a dialogue between patients and physicians from Mayo Clinic, Cleveland Clinic, other places where these physicians have signed up. And what patients can go on and do for their particular malady, they can go in and look at what those dialogues have been between these trusted doctors and patients. And then they can ask their own questions. So I think there's a huge hunger for trusted, validated sources. And then you could argue, you could go and read it, and you might disagree with what's said there. But there is a lot of interest in that, clearly, in the paper.
I think I raised an interesting question, which goes back to what I was asking about, does, you know, change the traditional model? You know, all the companies that have been on the program, the earlier panel today, and you guys as investors, you know, build off existing expertises in areas that you know well. When you start talking about that kind of stuff, or the kind of stuff that you're talking about, where there isn't, you know, a lot of ingrained expertise, does that become harder or more challenging for companies who, you know, grew up in the
Thank you. I wanted to address John's point that patients are not doctors. Thank you.
Sense. The only thing that changes, they picked up a different color box. Okay, so that is a very, very rare opportunity that you'll have where it falls into an existing customer doing the exact same thing with the exact same platform. So, but what that has led to is a huge amount of interest in what I'll call site-specific localized drug delivery. And there will be markets that, so what that did was it caused enough interest in that area that there's a significant amount of investment that's happened since then on doing that. So what would the areas be? Obviously, we've invested in things that
choose one.
Companies like that, smart external products that have the same functionality based on new technologies and the convergence of new technologies to give you the same answers in a non-invasive way that implantable devices get, or can add to that, or can network implantable devices and do different things, or form a closed loop. So those would be areas that I think, because they fit into the current business model.
Brian, you hear body computing, what breakout standard technology comes to the market?
psychiatric patient. There's a caregiver out there that has serious issues that impact their life, points of pain, around managing the care and more than safety and life of that patient. And some of these external wearable devices have the potential to provide consumer value to that caregiver in a way that is, in some sense, even in some sense, outside of the traditional medical device.
So a more sophisticated lifeline. You know, Lifeline's a $100 million business, just a medallion, not very sophisticated.
Simple.
Right.
What we've got is a huge opportunity. So our dialogue with the board is about some of that. I think it's going to be really exciting what's going to happen next decade. But we actually talk about real cold body computing, but it's conversions of wireless and devices. Can we get the power down on some of these devices? Yes, no problem. We know how to solve some of those problems. Can we make them smaller? Yes, we know how to do that. So we don't view this as a technology problem. And the frustrating part is, I think it's a business model problem where executions have very little impact. It's what technologies can so we get from some of the point of view, what is software and services will make it valuable to the physicians or the caregivers. We've got to solve those problems and the technology piece, I think, will take care of itself.
Continuous and it works at night when people are sleeping, so it's convenient. And I'd add that to the rewired nervous system, so they're all really good.
Yeah, that's right.